All right, we are recording to the cloud. Of course, if people missed this, they can watch the recorded version. If you think this is so good, you need to watch it twice. You're gonna get the replay. I'd like to thank everyone for joining to our new schedule, which is gonna be once a week on Thursdays at 10 o'clock. I know a bunch of people have texted Sam and me that they're traveling. Apparently Sam said this is like the second busiest travel day of the year. They're traveling. They're going to miss it. We're going to send them the replay. So we're just grateful that you're here and you're willing to work with our team during the holiday season. And as we begin, I'm going to mute all of you. But when you speak, I'd really welcome when you join or when we call on you, I'd really welcome your contributions. I think by now we know this is best when it's interactive and more engaging as a community and as a team. My good friend and former client of ours, Matthew O'Callaghan, is home. I'd like to call on him perhaps in a minute just to kind of summarize the length of his sentence, the productivity while in prison, now that he's home looking to rebuild and grow. And his growth, I think, will be easier because Matthew did a very good job of building that release plan in custody, which is going to make things on the other side a little bit easier. Okay. With that said, Matthew, welcome. I'd love it if you would just give us a minute, Matt, on the length of your sentence. How long did you serve? And a quick little minute or so summary of your experience at Lewisburg Federal Prison Camp.
No problem. Good morning. Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. So I got arrested in March 2020 and, you know, went through the process. I was quickly introduced to Justin's team, which proved invaluable. It was a case where I wanted to take accountability right away. I found that to be very helpful in my process. I knew what I did wrong and I just wanted to get it over with. It was a little challenging in the height of the pandemic, but once I got the wheels moving and, you know, with guidance from these gentlemen, I was able to go through my pre-sentence. I had a good experience with my PSR and my interview. That went smoothly. I was able to incorporate everything I needed to incorporate. My sentence was a little bit harsh, but I knew that going in. I knew I had a firmer judge, so I was sentenced to 51 months. I took that, standing up. I was designated to Lewisburg Camp in Central Pennsylvania. I was able to go there. Unfortunately, they had an RDAP program for me. I was able to enroll in RDAP, which was a real blessing. I enjoyed the program. I enjoyed the living quarters. I enjoyed the people I met there. It was a better structure and a cleaner facility, for lack of a better term. So, as I'd mentioned earlier, I just was released from Lewisburg about a month ago. I'm in a halfway house currently in New Jersey and, trying to stay productive. While I was at Lewisburg, there was a number of things that I did to help my mind and body strengthen and get ready for, keep the process moving and keep looking forward to the future. I was able to cut a bunch of weight through, daily exercise, which was helpful. I was sort of got re-engaged in my faith-based, going back to church and things of that nature, and I found a lot of solace in that. I also, some of the things that helped was I had three jobs while I was at Lewisburg. That's a strange thing that no one speaks of, but I was able to keep myself busy and sort of fulfill my narrative while working there. That helped me keep a good mindset. Additionally, one of the big activities I did for myself was I did a lot of writing while I was away. I did a lot of journaling, which I found helpful for my head. But additionally, I had written probably north of a dozen business plans that I think will all hold water going forward. Which ones I get put into practice will wait to be seen, but it's a good way to sort of keep yourself on your toes and to look forward to the future.
Well, thank you for sharing that. And everything that Matthew just touched on relates to his reentry plan. It's easy to think your reentry plan will begin once you are in prison. And many of you who have already been sentenced, I know, feel a sense of frustration that you didn't do a number of things leading up to sentencing that you wish you would have. Jason, Larry, I know you have said that repeatedly. We can't change the past, though what you can work to do is to be authentic and genuine with all of the stakeholders moving forward and articulate what you did both good and bad. So our team encourages everyone to do a few things. One is you build out your release plan, which we're going to discuss today. It's essential, we think, that you are watching our prior webinars on disciplinary infractions. Matthew O'Callaghan is home from prison earlier, in part. He did not have any disciplinary infractions in prison. He knew it was of higher value to engage in programming, create his reentry plan, avoid the TV room, the drama, the hustling, the gambling, get home to his wife and children and get on with his life. It was deliberate. It was strategic. It wasn't by accident. I say it every week. You are not prepared for prison if you don't watch the lesson plan on disciplinary infractions. You are not prepared for prison if you don't understand the differences between the First Step Act, CARES Act, Second Chance Act, because of course, as you build your reentry plan, you're going to build information into the release plan on your health issues. We would encourage you to visit the CDC website. It's constantly updating with what may qualify for an earlier release due to COVID and health issues as the prison sees it. You're going to need to build that information into your release plan. Please spend the time watching our webinars. It's not enough just to attend for an hour every week. You must do the work in between, as Matt and Jason and so many people in our community have absolutely done. If you have yet to be sentenced, you are already, of course, creating your release plan. That may start with the personal narrative. We'd encourage you, if you have not written your personal narrative, to write it immediately, presuming it's the right message. We applaud people who try to create their narrative or who try to write their own reentry plan with the free resources that we give you. And from time to time, we'll review the message. And despite your valiant efforts, you may have missed the message. You may have missed the mark. So while we applaud you for doing the work, you need someone objective to review it and ask the question, does this advance your agenda? Does this get you closer to success as you identify it? And most importantly, are you writing your narrative and release plan from the perspective of the stakeholders? And that's what I want to discuss for a moment. Who are these stakeholders? Sam Mangel, can you give us an idea from your experience through prison who these various stakeholders are?
Well, it starts with your pretrial officer. It then goes to the AUSA and ultimately to the judge who's going to sentence you. Once you've been sentenced, that then transitions over to your case manager at the facility, your counselor, eventually a warden who might need to approve an early release. Once you're out, then it transitions to another case manager and counselor at a halfway house. Or if you're on home confinement, then who's ever monitoring you and the case manager. Once you're out of the halfway house or home confinement, then you're on supervised release. I don't know if you heard, I'm hopefully going to be finished supervised release early. I'm doing this from the Turks and Caicos in the Bahamas. I'm still on supervised release. So part of influencing the stakeholders is by saying to a supervised release officer, I'd like to get my passport back and I'd like to begin traveling. How do you influence everybody who's going to have a say in your future, in your life at each step of the way? There's going to be a lot of different people pulling the strings at each step of the way. And you have to know what are the touch points and what are the tools and resources you need to accomplish that.
That's well said. So as you create your narrative / release plan, we want you to write it from the perspective of the stakeholders. Put yourself in their shoes. What is the position of the U.S. attorney? They want to advance their career. They want convictions. Many of you have had horrific Department of Justice press releases that you do not agree with. So the question is, they have their narrative. They have their perspective. Put yourself in their shoes when you create and write. The narrative, accept responsibility, demonstrate a path and plan moving forward, why you'll never return to another courtroom. That's an integral part of your release plan. If you've already been sentenced and you're not pleased with the messaging or the narrative, we want you to own it and be authentic. There's a lot of people that don't really truly feel remorse and shame and any at all until they go to prison, until they have time to think, time in memorial. That was the case with me. I kind of said whatever I needed to tell the judge to try to get the best outcome, but there wasn't a real sense of shame and remorse till I had time to think. And I wanted to own that and write about that and document it. So as you proceed through this arc, sentencing, prison after prison, and as you create content, we want you to put yourself in the shoes of these stakeholders. With respect to the reentry plan, we want you to put yourself in the shoes of a case manager. Many of them are nice and they want to help you, and they're very giving of their time. Many of them get a bad rap, but many of them are kind and want to see that you're successful. Does it advance your agenda if you are sharing this release plan with a case manager and actually giving them credit for your release plan, thanking them for supporting you throughout this journey? Does that make them look better? Our team believes that it does. So what you've got to do, and I shared this in a message I sent yesterday to everyone on our list, too many people try to outsource all of the work. They try to outsource the work to a lawyer who's going to write a memorandum. They outsource to people who are going to write character reference letters, which are certainly part of the mitigation process. There is no question. But they don't do the self-advocacy. They don't invest the time. I'll remind you, it was Judge Boulware, federal judge in Nevada, who said, the order of mitigation follows the defendant, lawyer, friends, and family. You cannot outsource the release plan to a lawyer or to a third party to write. Now, someone can help you create it. You want the right messaging. But whether we help you or you do it on your own, it has to convey the right message. You do not advance your agenda if a case manager asks you, where's your release plan? And you say, what? Or you say, well, I don't have a release plan. Didn't my lawyer send you a letter that states why I should get out of prison early during COVID? These things happen. They shred that letter. It goes nowhere. The lawyer is not involved in the process in prison. Sure, you can retain a lawyer to try to file a compassionate release with your judge. But even then, what would compel a judge to release you early? What would compel a federal probation officer to let you off probation early? It's you. It's you doing the work. It's you investing the time. It's you documenting what you've learned and how you've grown and what your plans are moving forward. So if you take one thing away from the hour webinar that we're going to do today before Christmas, let it be this. You cannot outsource that work to lawyers or anybody. You've got to take the initiative. You've got to take the lead, and you've got to develop and grow it. We frequently say this release plan, we're going to go through a release plan here in a little bit. This release plan should be completed before you should, it should begin before you surrender to prison. It is a dynamic growing document. It's not a static document. It's going to grow, evolve in the weeks and months, and for some of you, years that you're going to be in federal prison. You should have the makings of it down, and then it's going to grow in prison. So when you meet with a case manager, you are different from the banker from Philly whose wife Angela called to tell me that the case manager asked him, where's your release plan? He was like, I don't even know what you're talking about. What's a release plan? Sam, if you're still there, Matt, Sam Mangel, tell us quickly that first team meeting and the expectations that a prisoner may have for a team meeting versus how the case manager may actually view it.
So everybody will meet with the case manager within about 2 to 3 weeks of getting there. And that lasts all of about 45 seconds. You walk in, they hand you a computation sheet, which says, here's what you've been charged with. Here's your release date, sign it, leave. I like to think I'm very affable and outgoing, and I wanted to shake this person's hand and say, hi, how are you? I'd like to meet you. No, you have 15 seconds, sign it and leave. Depending upon your sentence, you're going to be back in front of that same person either 3 or 6 months later. At that time, you have two choices because there's possibly 9 other guys or women standing in line all to see the case manager on that day to sign the same piece of paper. You can walk in there and have the same reception here, sign the piece of paper and leave. Typically, they're going to ask you a question. Have you been programming? Typical question. What are you doing? Are you programming? And when you can walk in there and say, not only have I been taking the following classes, not only have I been working in this position, but let me show you what I've been doing. Here is my release plan. Here is what I've been doing. Here is what I did to get here. Here's what I've been doing while I'm here to better myself. Here is what I plan to do when I go home. Here's where I'm going to be living and with whom I'm going to be living. And if I have insurance and a driver's license, now all of a sudden, You've created an opportunity to talk to the case manager because they rarely, if ever, see that. And you've stood out from the 9 other people standing in line waiting to sign the piece of paper. You've created a reason for him or her, the case manager, to say, hold on. You know, you're the purple cow and the herd of brown ones that differentiates you. And presenting a viable reentry plan, release plan to them at that second meeting, even maybe on the first meeting, but you won't have time to necessarily speak about it, is your key to standing out and giving a reason for you to get out as quickly as possible. You need to give the reason. They're not going to do it for you.
So thank you. What I would encourage, all of you are marketers, right? That's it. You're selling. You're marketers. The primary reason people are here, they want to learn strategies to get the shortest sentence. If prison is part of the process, how do they get out as quickly as possible? Yet some people are told what to do. They don't do it, like outsourcing to a lawyer, not creating the release plan, or worse, they write a message that does not put the perspective of the stakeholders first. I didn't mean to do it. I didn't have bad intentions. I'm a first-time nonviolent offender. It might be true to you. Is it right for the stakeholder reading the message? And I'll tell all of you, if you have conveyed that message to a probation officer or sentencing judge, own it, be authentic, and address how you've changed since you've been in custody. Because the journey doesn't end. We interviewed Chris Maloney, the former head of probation, who said, the first thing your probation officer is going to do is read your probation report. And if you have the wrong message in that probation report, that's okay. You weren't prepared. We can't change the past. Let's do better. Correct the message. If your judge said something to you that was hard and embarrassing and didn't believe you, called you a thug or a criminal, we recently had someone sentenced first time. The judge said, I think you've been doing this throughout your life. It's the first time you got caught. Not a great thing to hear. Judges will frequently say, I think you're telling me this because it's what I want to hear. I don't even know if you're going to follow through. You're only sorry because you got caught. This is the perspective of some stakeholders. So your release plan gives you an opportunity to change the narrative your judge or your probation officer may have of you, because years down the road, that's all the probation officer is going to see. So if you are not marketing or selling and writing and creating compelling content, you're going to be like some of the people who reach out to our community who want something and then don't do it. That doesn't make any sense to us. We want to help you, and we're getting all of it to you for free at no expense. It's just your time. It's all on our website at Prison Professors, including a release plan that we're going to go through in a few minutes. But I just want to reiterate, you are marketers. You are selling. Many of you found our team. We didn't cold call you, hire us, join our webinar, do a little bit of marketing, but it's generally you found a book, a blog, a podcast, a media article, something of value we produced, and you said, I'm going to opt into these people I don't know on the internet, give them my email, let's see if they can help me. We produced content as marketers, at least through the white collar side, because everything is free through Prison Professors, but we produced something that compelled you to think, maybe these dudes can help me. Let's give it a shot. You are marketers. We understand our message. We understand our audience. It's why you chose to give us your email and join our free webinar. Do you understand your audience? So if you are going to create the narrative, make sure it's on track. If you'd like to review or work with our team to ensure that it's the right messaging for the narrative or the release plan, we are available. Because what we don't want is for you to invest the time to create a beautiful release plan and the messaging is off, or you imply that it wasn't your fault, or you are inconsistent with the message you give staff versus what you may say to your wife via email or via a letter or via good old snail mail or over the phone. And what I mean is, I shared the story a few months ago of someone who was going through the residential drug abuse program, and Matt went through this program, so did Sam, went through the program, told the RDAP coordinator, this class is great, I'm changing my criminal thinking patterns, everything a case manager would want to hear. And then over the phone with his wife was admonishing the program as a waste and just a waste of time. But hey, I got to do what I got to do to get the time off, right? Matt, what happens when you give an inconsistent message like that in prison? What would a consequence of that? I'll tell you what happened to this prisoner, but what's something that could happen if a prisoner does that? I'm asking you or Sam, what would happen if a prisoner gives an inconsistent message? You're on mute right now. You can unmute yourself. Go ahead.
It's simple. I remember seeing situations where the different counselors within RDAP, because they all read emails and listen to phone calls, would call somebody into the RDAP meeting. It's called a team, and they would interview the RDAP participant and ask them, you know, what's up? You signed a statement that you're going to participate. You needed this treatment. You understood the rules surrounding the treatment. And yet here's an email to your wife mocking it and saying you're just doing it for the time off and you're just going to toe the party line. And in one occasion, this person did it at least twice and got thrown out of the program and had to reapply 9 months later, which added a year onto a sentence.
Matt, do you concur?
Absolutely. It's the type of thing where you need to be on your game and, you know, be thorough. And what I mean by that is have that message run throughout your entire existence while in custody, from your communications with the outside, even, you know, like you said, your wife, your friends, whoever it might be, to how you behave while you're away. You don't want to be saying one thing in front of the counselors or in front of the stakeholders and then be totally contradictory in the back rooms with your pals or your friends or at the gym or, you know, so you want to stay on message. And it makes it easier if you fully believe the message. And what that is, you know, you're in RDAP or whatever for a behavior change and, you know, buying into it, it will be helpful.
And to Matt's point, some of you believe in it and you want to make the change. I know some of you with whom we've all spoken are irate and sickened that you're going to prison. We know many of you shouldn't be going to prison, should be civil. We empathize with you. We're sorry that you're enduring this process. We're sorry you're going through this crisis. We want to help. And the way that we can help is by reminding you to the point where you may be thinking, how many times is Justin going to say it? Put yourself in the perspective of the stakeholders. If you say one thing to a case manager, are you consistent with your messaging over the phone, via email and good old snail mail? Are you consistent? Are you saying one thing and doing another? Because they are expecting to catch you in a gotcha moment. Aha, there you go again. You're manipulating, you're exploiting us, you're a criminal, you're in prison after all. Here you go again. If you're not working to change that narrative, you're not ready to create your release plan in our experience. You are marketers, you are salespeople. Embrace that, create the right message. And as you create it, thank staff. Give them the credit. They're used to hearing prisoners complain, I need more halfway house time, I want a better job, I want a better bunk, the peanut butter in the commissary has too much sugar, this is ridiculous. That's what they're used to hearing. We encourage you to go down a different path. Thank you for encouraging me to enroll in programming. In fact, the program that you suggested I enroll in has been so impactful. I've actually been writing about it extensively in my release plan. May I share it with you? Different message, it's strategic, but it does require you to do the work. With that said, by the way, if you have questions, add them to chat. Our team will respond. If you also have questions, put your hand up. I will call on you as we transition to the release plan. Now, we have a release plan book that Michael Santos wrote. We sent you, let me unmute everyone here. 1 second, sounds like someone's at an airport. 1 second. We've sent you repeatedly, and we'll send it again if you need it, the PDF and Word document to Michael Santos's release plan. Now, for those of you who are working with our team in the post-sentencing capacity, upon your surrender to prison, we're going to send you 5 books that Michael has written, but we'll send you the PDF and the Word plan. If you'd actually like this, feel free to buy the book at Prison Professors, all the resources support our nonprofit, which is what enables us to do these webinars for free for all of you every single week. But I encourage you to review Michael's plan, whether you get the book or go through the PDF. With that said, I mentioned some stuff is going to be static as you create your release plan. Obviously, the name, date of birth, today's date, sentence length, things of that nature, those things aren't going to change. All of this you can get done before prison, because when you're in prison, it can be an inconvenience if you're calling home. Send me the driver's license. I need the image of this. I'm building out my release plan. You can do it, but why blow through valuable phone minutes if you can get this done in about 9 minutes, right? In 9 minutes, it would take to get a copy of your driver's license, Social Security card, birth certificate, your insurance card, things of that nature. It's not an overwhelming task in our experience, but this is the release plan template that you should begin to fill in. Support information. Now, I think these things are important. Why? Studies show the higher level of support that you have, housing, employment, a network, the less likely you are to reoffend. they assess you from a kind of a perspective of, are you likely to break the law again? Sam's in the Bahamas in part because he has demonstrated through his efforts that he can be compliant on probation, that he can be compliant and travel and work with criminals, which I am. That wasn't by accident. He didn't show up and say, hi, may I do this? He had a record that he was able to show. You need that record. So as you build it, I think letters are a good idea. It's not as important as what you do. Let's remember what Judge Boulware said, defendant, lawyers, friends, and family. Well, now that you're in prison, as you create the reentry plan, it's now prisoner, friends, and family. Lawyers out of the equation because you're in prison. So we encourage you to use the character reference letters that you've obtained for sentencing. Stay in touch with your network. Reach out to them. Let them know your plans in custody. You could attach some of those letters, especially if there's one from an employer, or you can get the letters adjusted as you serve your time in prison. I have said before, occasionally when our team works with people on character reference letters, some people with whom we have spoken have said, I feel kind of used. I got a call from Joe out of the blue 3 years later when I learned he's going to prison. And then I heard from him again when he's home from prison asking for a letter. I feel used. He's not staying in touch with me. I'm happy to help him. I love the dude. I've known him for 30 years, but it doesn't really feel like he's changed to me. So as you build your release plan, we encourage you to continue to stay in touch with people, prove worthy of that love and support they're giving you, nurture networks. But also, if you have an employment opportunity, you should include that letter in this release plan and thank your case manager for the idea. Thank your case manager for suggesting that you grow your network and line up employment opportunities, because Google how tough it is to thrive after prison. The statistics are troubling. So if you can show that level of awareness to your case manager and thank them for giving you the idea to reach out to employers or engage in programming, does it advance your agenda? Probably. We think so. And it just doesn't advance your agenda with a case manager. It's with a probation officer down the road who is going to review it. So support information, letter from a primary support. Now, in Michael's case, he had myriad letters throughout his journey, but there's one from Carol Santos, his wife. They married, I think, 11 years left into his prison term. Michael married. His work helped sustain her and put her through nursing school, shows a great level of support, because on the other side, he has a wife with a stable income and a home. That would potentially give him higher levels of liberty, which he had. It wasn't by accident. The question is, if he came home and just told a probation officer this, is that different than showing the probation officer this? We want you to show, not just tell them. They are used to hearing things and they don't believe it. They discount it. You've got to show them. So support information is very helpful. And in the release plan that we'll share with you with Michael, you're going to read the actual letters from Carol. You're going to read the actual letters from people who have supported Michael along this journey. And then you're going to look at it and think, I want to do something akin to that. In our opinion, you should. Things that help, of course, transportation. Share that with a case manager. Proof of insurance. Housing situation. Now, some people are more verbose than others. Some people work on their narrative. If they work on it with our team, we ask them, how's upbringing? They'll say, good. Okay. How was it? Bad. What were your parents like? They were nice. They were good people. Okay, that's honest, I suppose. But does it really advance your agenda if you're working as a salesperson, if you're a marketer? Does it make more sense to express in your housing situation the stability that you have? We rent, we own, we live here for this period of time. This is the living situation. You need to write it out. You need to describe with whom you will be living. Is there a landline there? Why is that relevant? Perhaps when you're in the halfway house and you're on a pass, as I understand it, Matt, maybe you can tell me, I don't know if you're home yet, or Sam, don't they need a landline they need to call?
Not anymore.
Yeah.
Now it might be different in certain districts, but the purpose of the landline was more for the bracelet for home confinement, but they've gone away from that. It's now GPS or cellular.
Got it. So you wanted
to guard.
Go ahead.
Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. I just wanted to clarify that the GPS isn't everywhere. And in certain districts, and I can speak from experience, it's still ankle and it's still, you need that landline. And a lot of people didn't know that coming here, and they got hung up here because of that. I was lucky enough to have my wife take care of that to ensure that we had that landline, and that helped with my past situation, things of that nature. So certain districts still need that.
That's right. So these are things you want to prepare for. We'd hate to have you stuck in the halfway house an extra 2 weeks while you wait to get a landline set up, because I know so few people even have them anymore. This is why we want you to be proactive. So these are things that you can knock out as you prepare to go to prison, as you're getting ready to come home. You want to get these things set up. But to the extent that you can write out and describe your housing situation, it advances your agenda. Because one, they can see that you've actually taken the time to do it. And also, I recognize that your living situation might have changed because of your conviction. They like humility. They like deference. They like knowing that you've been punished, you're suffering consequences, you're rebuilding, and you're not complaining, but you're taking action. So if some of you had a different home or living situation in the pre-sentence interview and are now in a different financial situation because you lost your job or your conviction or the forfeiture or the restitution, you got to talk about that. You got to own that. You've got to be able to say, because of my criminal actions in creating victims, I went to prison. I lost my career and my licenses, and I lost the beautiful home my family and I once lived in. And now, instead of a 3,500 square foot home, we're living in a 1,000 square foot apartment, but we're getting through it together. Can you understand how that message can advance your agenda rather than, yes, I have a nice stable home, I live with my family? Humility, deference, lessons learned. I broke the law. These are the consequences, but I'm doing better because of prison, because of the programs that you've encouraged me to participate in, because of RDAP and the lessons that I've learned. I'm no longer going to drink or do substances. Because of this parenting class that I went through, I'm going to be a better father, and I'm going to pay more attention to my children, have a better work-life balance, or be a better husband. Whatever the message is, it does no good if they don't know. It's like you could be the best marketer in the world, but if nobody knows, who cares? What point? It doesn't matter. You're marketers, you're selling. You have to build this out in a way, just like you did with your personal narrative. But it's got to be the right message, not because of my case and the prosecutor ruining my life. I'm now living in some hellhole. And you may feel that way, and it may be true, but does it advance your agenda in the eyes of the stakeholders? Probably not. We want you to be very honest and authentic with your living, not just your living situation, but your ability to earn an income. And what it is you plan to do when you come home. What does your financial future look like right now? Some of you have said, well, I don't know what it's going to look like in the future. This is a growing dynamic document. You can articulate what it looks like today and what you hope it will look like in the future. And the work that you're going to put in every day is going to get you there. As we continue through this, and again, you'll have access to Michael Santos's plan where he writes all of this out in exhaustive detail. We do want you to transition into specific programs that you participated in. So for example, Matt, I know you went through RDAP, or if you can engage, what are the presets of RDAP? What would a case manager like to hear about RDAP and how it helped you? What would you put into a release plan for someone who went through the drug program? What do they want to hear?
Absolutely. You know, it's interesting. Going into RDAP, you know, it's called the residential drug program, but what it really is a behavioral program. They don't speak very frequently about drugs or alcohol in specific fashion. It's really what got you to the point that made you major decisions in an improper fashion. You know, how can you deal with stress to move forward in a healthier way without, you know, coming back to prison? They want to know that you have learned the precepts of the program. What are some of your personal triggers? What will cause you harm in the future? What will cause others harm in the future? And that you have learned how to navigate that from things that are simple as, you know, getting proper diet and sleep and exercise and having a physical health to learning how to cope with different stresses, maybe via exercise or prayer or some other outlet. So they want to know that you are understanding, not just you did something bad or, you know, you potentially have done bad things in the past, but why you did that. You know, if that would have happened in the future, how would you handle that and mitigate that and, you know, navigate those roadblocks?
Everything you're doing, you're putting yourself in the eyes of the stakeholder. Someone recently said to me, "Why I'd like to go through RDAP, but I'm not going to do it because I'm not going to get the time off. Their sentence was too short." And my response was, I believe the drug coordinator can let you in. You may not get the time off, but does to advance your agenda, if you build into your release plan, why you enrolled in RDAP, even though you wouldn't get any time off, how the program benefited you. Is that valuable information you think you should share with your probation officer? And his response was, yeah, you're right. I think it would benefit me. But initially, he wasn't going to do it. You've got to put yourself in the position of these stakeholders. Now, as we go down this release plan, I'm actually going to give you a sample response from Michael, and then I'll go back to the screen share. So for example, on page 31 of the release plan, we write job skills and training you have, job skills and training you need, job placement status, special skills you've developed or have. All of you have skills. You're successful. You've done good things throughout your life. Just because you're going to prison, your skills aren't removed, but you need to write them out. You need to articulate them, especially if you want the probation officer to approve the work. So for example, Michael wrote his sample response. While incarcerated, I spent time developing marketable skills. Specifically, I became skilled with verbal communications and public speaking, as evidenced by the many courses I created and taught inside the various prisons that confined me. Writing and editing skills, as evidenced by publishing contracts with some of the nation's leading publishers. Critical thinking skills, as evidenced by the support network I built. Business development, is evidenced by the savings account I built while in prison. Self-directed work ethic is evidenced by the body of work I created during my term. Everything that Michael just wrote isn't just happy talk, as he would say. He has the evidence to back it up. It's something that he could share with a case manager, with a probation officer, and eventually with a sentencing judge. Because guess what? If any of you want to get off probation early, guess the person who's going to deny or approve getting off your probation early? Most likely your sentencing judge, if he's alive and hasn't retired. So the work that you're doing is throughout this whole journey, building this release plan may eventually get back in front of your sentencing judge. And if he had this cynicism or vitriol towards you at sentencing, you've got time to change that narrative. Matt had a very difficult sentencing judge. He was ruthless and tough and vicious. However, he's done a great job. He's built a new record. He's developed his reentry plan. At some point, he may go back to get off supervised release early, and it wouldn't surprise me if she approved it. But even if she doesn't, what has he done during this window of time? He's built a new record. He's developed skills. He's not doing it only because he wants to get off probation early. He's doing it to change his legacy, to get a job approved, to regrow his network and reputation. He's not doing it just for a specific outcome, get off probation early. The process and what you're documenting and showing is as vital as the end result, because we can't guarantee that your case manager is going to let you out early, can't guarantee the judge is going to let you off probation early, or that your narrative is going to lead to a shorter sentence. But there's value and dignity in doing the work as marketers, as salespeople, and growing and developing it. Any questions on the release plan? I speak quickly. I'm passionate about this. We want to help. Any questions or anything popping up along the way? Yes. Frank from Northern California, talk to me, Goose. What's the question? You have to unmute yourself. Unmute yourself.
Thank you, Maverick. My question is with regard to, excuse me, the job and coming home. I've been in professional practice for about four decades, and that planning on keeping, all my sites and everything alive while I'm in. I've got 1 year and 1 day sentence. Don't know which prison camp I'm going to be assigned to yet. But the judge, who was a very, very good judge, Judge Lyman in New York, put no prohibition on my ability to practice when I came home. But how would I explain that I intend to do the best job I can in continuing my practice when I get home?
So thank you for the question. There's one thing our team stresses. We want to be honest. You want to articulate that you have been very forthright with people about your criminal conviction. You want to acknowledge that you made mistakes and you broke the law. What are some of the lessons learned? That you've been transparent with your community, your employers, or people that hire you. You want to show that you've changed. You want to give them every reason to approve your line of work or return to a career. What too many people do is they don't create the release plan. They've gone through all these programs in prison. Sometimes people get a certificate for a walking class they think is going to be so significant. You've got to show them why you're worthy of returning to the career that you'd like. Because so many people come home, they tell their probation officer they'd like to do it. The probation officer says no, then they get angry, then they get depressed, then they're in the halfway house with their job not approved, and they say, I wish I was back in the minimum security camp exercising and watching TV. So we can't guarantee, Frank, that your probation officer is going to approve it. Does it advance your agenda if you document what you've learned, how you've grown from prison, how you have thanking your case manager for encouraging you along this way, and sharing that work with the probation officer? We think if you're able to do that, you advance your agenda. Now, I'm going to mute everyone again as we come back to this and encourage all of you with FRP, Financial Responsibility Program. Now, eventually, you know, right now, I believe it's still voluntary. Some people have even had sentences that don't require them to pay FRP in prison. Then the case manager will say you're going to pay $25 or $50 a month. And the prisoner gets upset and they make a big deal over it. You may have an argument to not pay, but does it advance your agenda if you owe restitution? If you say, I'm going to pay the $25 or $50 a month. In some cases, someone in our community is paying $180 a month because they had so much money come in, or they just had too much money come in. $180 a month they're taking. They're frustrated, they're angry, they're mad. But if you build into your release plan that you're making these payments, it shows that you're following through on the commitment you made to the judge, which is, I'm going to make my victims whole. Some people are like, dude, I owe $23 million in restitution. That's absurd. No, it's not absurd. What's absurd is if you told the judge you're going to work the rest of your life to make amends and you put up a stink about paying $50 a quarter. Does that likely lead to higher levels of liberty on probation or getting off supervised release early? I don't think so. So even in Michael's sample release plan, he gave credit to his team manager. He wrote, with guidance from my unit team, I participated in the Bureau of Prisons Financial Responsibility Program, my obligation to pay a fine ceased after 20 years. Through hard work and ingenuity, I began creating income-generating products to assist my transition to society. I set a goal of having sufficient savings to live for at least 1 year, regardless of income. Can you understand that rather than saying no or I paid it reluctantly, articulate to a case manager, yes, as a consequence of my conduct, I created victims, I owe money, and when you tell me to pay, I'm going to pay. And you should do the same thing, by the way, when you're on probation, something that I did, many people in our community have done, because it advances your agenda. It may come with a higher price, the money, but at what cost? Potentially more liberty, job approval, things of that nature. San Miguel is a very good example filming this video from the Bahamas. I want you giving thought to all of that as you're working on your release plan. The release plan can become exceptionally long as you get crazy detailed into what you expect to do in the future. If you've written a good narrative for sentencing, it's going to articulate your plans for the future and why you'll never return to another courtroom. And if you've put that in your narrative and sentencing statement, which you should have, if not, please do so. You're also going to want to build this into your release plans in prison. So for example, discuss your plans and goals for the future. Jason Larry, are you with us, Jason?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
I know you're going in January 10th. You've been on so many of our webinars. I'd love to make this interactive, and we don't need to go on for hours here, but you've been with us for a while now. Could you just, if I were to ask you this question, just give us a minute or two. Jason, you're sitting down in prison, or you're about to go in January 10th. You're on this webinar for release plans. You have our template. You know eventually you're going to give this to a case manager, right, a probation officer. Perhaps your sentencing judge will see it someday. Your prosecutor may see it because they may approve or deny your request to get off probation early. How would you respond, discuss your plans and goals for the future? Are you prepared to give some insights on what you'd write?
I am. I because of you guys, I've learned to start this early. And so what I've done was contacted some of the my relationships with a nonprofit for working with youths, here in the Atlanta area. The problem that we're having here, we're having an extreme violence problem in the Atlanta area with our youths. So I've been on a program with my friends called Brains, Not Bullets. And it's a nonprofit to be able to help train these kids coming up to stop being violent. And That's just part of the work that I've beginning to show from that standpoint while I'm still here. The second thing is that I've been working on a financial literacy program for at-risk youth that quit school early here in the metropolitan Stonecrest and Atlanta area. So I'm using my time wisely before I go in so that I can, you know, help train those that are coming up to not make the same mistakes that I made.
So thank you. What's relevant with what Jason just said is something you have to consider as we go back to the stakeholders. I attended a sentencing hearing where a defendant said similar things to a sentencing judge. And the judge kind of quasi laughed at him and said, "You want to help others, you haven't yet helped yourself. You're telling me what I want to hear. You haven't put any of the work to get there." So the difference between that person who, when questioned by the judge, acknowledged, "I haven't done it, but I'd like to." The difference between that person and Jason is, Jason, rather than talk about it, he's going to build out what that looks like. He's going to build out what that program looks like, perhaps try to get some evidence and outcomes of how the program is helping people. Again, it's showing, not telling, and putting yourself in the shoes of the stakeholders who are skeptical. So we could spend days discussing this. We won't, but it's going to require you to do the work. You're going to be the one in prison. It requires you to write out what these goals are, both short and long term, knowing they're going to evolve, knowing it's going to pivot. And they expect it to pivot, but you can't pivot unless you start and you begin to document it. That much I know.
One thing I picked up from Scott is that I'm going to have this website done before I go in. It'll be finished so that once I'm actually in, anyone can go out there to the site and look at the work that we've done and created before, I'm sent to the shoe.
Right. So that's correct. Some people do choose to put their release plan on a website. Most do not, whether it's a website or it's just something you're creating for your case manager and probation officer and family. We encourage you to do it. And we really want you to get creative. We want you to use your critical thinking skills and give thought to what can I put in this release plan that will influence my prospects for success in prison and when I'm released. And you want a plan that shows that you're learning and growing. So for example, something that Michael wrote about in the release plan, something that Scott Laney did extensively from prison, was every book that Michael or Scott wrote, I did this at times, every book they wrote a book report. Why did they read it? How will it help them in prison? How will it help them after prison? Can you understand how building a simple book report into a release plan could advance your agenda? Because then your probation officer can review it and think, "Wow, you were pretty damn productive in prison. This is helpful. Thank you." If God forbid you make bad decisions in prison or you get a disciplinary infraction, there's one thing we stress, it's authenticity. If you don't feel like you were truly remorseful at sentencing, own it, talk about it, share what you've learned. There are people in prison who get written up for disciplinary infractions. People have good and bad intentions. We know someone who got a disciplinary infraction for a three-way phone call. Someone who got a disciplinary infraction because they went into another dorm without permission to see his buddy. Okay, disciplinary infraction, is it devastating? Not really. He didn't lose any good time or go to the hole, but there were some consequences. He has a disciplinary infraction on his record. Well, you got to talk about that in the release plan. Acknowledge that you made a mistake and you strayed and it's not going to happen again. They're going to know everything. There are people every now and again who may create a release plan and they don't disclose that, 23 years ago, they had a disorderly conduct or a DUI. They have everything. What you don't want to do is build up something beautiful and authentic and then you withhold something and they say, "Oh, he still thinks like a criminal. He's trying to trick and fool us." We believe the more you share, the more you own it, the more they're in a position to help you, and the more you're in a position to advance your agenda. What Michael did, something that you can do, Michael was in a very long time, so you can see he was writing out his accomplishments year over year. He was in a long time. You don't have to do it year over year. Frank's going in for a year and a day. Frank hopefully is out of prison pretty quickly. He doesn't have to do year over year, thankfully, but he can do month to month to do a quick summary of his accomplishments within the first month. Wouldn't be hard to do, yet so many people don't do it. It would probably take 4 minutes to summarize what Matt did month over month in prison, or what Frank is going to do. This is the type of work we encourage you to build into your reentry plan, which shows why, even though you're going to start it before prison, it's going to continue to grow and evolve from prison. And we'd encourage you, as you work your way through your prison term, to share this work with your case, not just with your case manager, but actually write letters to your probation officer. Share excerpts of this with your probation officer from prison. You can even include the letters you've sent to your probation officer in the release plan. Does that make sense? Is there any questions with what I'm conveying to you right now? Is there any confusion or concern over the release plan? Because, Frank, I'll come to you in a moment. Because success, as our team views it, is following this webinar or at some point before the new year, that you can use the template we're sending you, or if you have real specific questions, reach out to Sam, we can help you. But success is, we see it as the follow-up from this webinar, the work you do after we hang up in 8, 15, or 20 minutes. And from our perspective, it's going to require you to sit down, begin to write, begin to think, do an honest assessment of what you've done up to where you are today. If you prepared poorly for sentencing, own it. If you have regrets over how you prepared for that pre-sentence report, own it. Talk about it, because then you have time to begin to build a new record. But if you don't, they're simply going to judge you by the government's versions of events, which I know sickens many of you, most of you. But if you don't correct it, whose fault is it? It's our fault. It's not their fault. They're doing what they think they're supposed to do from the position of a stakeholder: protect the community, ruin your reputation, try to deter others from breaking the law. If you don't work to change the narrative, these webinars are of no value to you. Truthfully, you need to create content. It's that specific. Frank, your hand was up.
Yeah, I'm actually just struck on a couple different points because for truth and disclosure, I've been very, very forthcoming about owning what I did, up to and including even statements to the press through my counsel. And then second was, with regard to, you know, a shorter sentence being involved with RDAP types of programs, it's my intent to present myself, you know, because there were some pain medication issues, but to present myself clean and sober, per se, before I go in April. But then subsequently, is it my understanding that there are programs inside, like NA or part of the RDAP program or whatever, and getting involved in those? And then subsequently, does that become part of your release plan?
I believe all of that work, everything that you're doing, whether it's to get treatment or help overcome addictions, is something that would be of value to someone who's going to determine if you can travel on probation, if they're going to approve your job. So yes, I think all of that work should be built into the plan, in our opinion. And the great thing is you're right. Now, we may edit it and kind of pare it down a little bit, and we don't want to get into the weeds with every bit of minutia or detail. But if we don't start, if we don't begin to write, we're missing really golden opportunities here. But I know the RDAP program, part of the reason people get the year off, I believe, is because you're less likely to reoffend if you're no longer going to use substances. So for that reason, you want to document programs, how they're benefiting you, whether it's RDAP or not, other programs, why you enrolled in them. There are people that go to team meetings that check off what programs they're participating in, and that's fine, I suppose. But does it really advance their agenda if they just say, I'm involved in a parenting class? We'd encourage you to say, I'm in a parenting class, and this is what I've learned from it, and I built it out in my reentry plan, and I'm sending it to my probation officer and network. If you can, and thank them for encouraging you to do it. As hard as that may be, I know that's going to be hard for some of you if you don't think they're worthy of it or deserve it. We know what you want, a more successful journey to try to get out as quickly as possible. And much like some of you might have struggled to articulate remorse, it might have helped you at sentencing. And I know many of you may not feel that remorse for weeks and years to come. Some of you may never feel it. We know your family suffers while you're in prison. and we know that people in prison will be making bad decisions. We want you to avoid that and remind you that there are, you know, aspects of this process that will be very difficult, right? And things can pop up. We shared the story recently of a prisoner in Tucson who got a gun, went into visitation, I think tried to kill his wife and children. Think about that. He was in a minimum security camp. We heard a story recently of someone who had a 6-month sentence who was raped in a medical facility. He's since been divorced and going through trauma and contemplated suicide on a 6-month sentence. So this is prison. You need to adjust well. You need to be very careful with the friendships that you form, how you associate, what you do. Because we hear every day, this is club fed. It's party time 101. It's prison and there are problems. And that's why you need to watch all of our webinars, disciplinary infractions, getting comfortable with being uncomfortable on the BOP. Spending time, like people may binge watch on Netflix. Spend time if you can. So get ready to post a... Spend time on prison professors. Spend some time listening to the subject matter experts like Hugh Hurwitz, the former director of the BOP. Hear him talk about the release plan and crafting and why it's relevant. There are people who have attended 8 or 9 webinars, and I've asked, have you heard the interview with Hugh Hurwitz? No, but I will. This is gold. It's 45 minutes. Listen to it. It will advance your agenda. Listen to federal probation officer Chris Maloney talk about what your eventual probation officer is going to do. We're giving you inside information here, but it's up to you to take it. It's up to you to act on it because you're the one that's going to be in prison, separated from your family, and many of you angry and upset that you're even there. But in our experience, those of you willing to do the work on those days, advance your agenda, get you closer to what it is. Listen to Halfway House and Home Confinement with John Gustin talk about employment opportunities after prison, how to get approved for the Halfway House with only 7,000 beds in the country. What can you do to advance your agenda? Starts with the release plan, can tell you that much. I see someone had raised their hand. I'm happy to call on them. The hand may be up, the hand may be down. Are there any, Sally, talk to me, Sally. Thank you very much for joining our webinar community. I'm happy to answer your question.
Hi, excuse me, can you hear me?
Yes.
I was wondering if they've designated you to a camp that doesn't have RDAP. Is there a way to get designated to a different camp that does have it, or are you just stuck where they send you?
I can answer that, Justin.
Go ahead.
Sally, do you qualify for RDAP?
I think I do. I mean, it's in my PSR report, so I would think that I do.
So they typically do not designate you to a facility if you qualify. I would need to see your pre-sentence report in order to confirm, in fact, you do qualify. Now, we've had other instances, there's someone on this call now that clearly qualified, but for some reason was designated to a camp that does not have RDAP. And the problem with that is you'll get interviewed at the facility that you're designated to, and if approved, they will then transfer you to a facility with RDAP. But that front end period that you're at the camp without it is downtime. The goal was to get into the program as quickly as possible. If you get to a camp that doesn't have it, it could take 6, 9, 12 months to get approved and transferred to a camp with it. And depending upon your sentence, that could be a very meaningful amount of downtime. So you can, and we've helped people. I think Jason's a good example. We've helped people get redesignated to facilities with RDAP if applicable and they do qualify. Yeah. But there are some nuances that go along with that.
Yeah, and to follow up on that, there are people that try to get redesignated, can't guarantee that you'll be successful, can't guarantee we don't know what they're going to do, but if you don't try, you have zero chance. We encourage people to work with their lawyer in the pre-sentencing process like Matthew did. When Matthew was sentenced, his lawyer asked for a specific prison. His lawyer asked the judge to make a recommendation for the drug program and a specific surrender date because you want enough time for the designation to come
right.
in.
Right. My attorney asked for Bryan College Station because I live in Texas, like within 2 hours of there.
What I would encourage you to do, knowing the recommendations are only that, a recommendation, but I think I read like 73% of judicial recommendations are followed by the BOP. P. So we would encourage you to have your lawyer, as soon as you're sentenced, ask the judge for a specific prison, ask the judge if there is a history of substance abuse in your pre-sentence report. You should probably be going to a counselor and documenting this process too.
I've already been sentenced. Okay.
Have you been to BOP.gov yet to get your registration number?
Yes, I have.
Okay, so what you could do, we did this earlier today with someone in our community. He was sentenced December 9th. He went to BOP.gov. He then called the marshal's office and they said, you've been designated. It happened within a week or two. So if you have your BOP number, you can very easily. What district were you sentenced in?
Eastern of Texas, Eastern, but I already know I'm going to Mariana in Florida.
Okay.
I don't know why they're sending me there, but.
So these are things that we can discuss offline. If it's not the prison of your choosing, it doesn't mean you can't try to seek a redesignation. These are things that, you know, I'd encourage you to perhaps have a conversation with Sam once we're offline. And if you don't get redesignated and you go to that prison and you're eligible for the drug program, as Sam mentioned, it's a process of trying to get approved and then transferred to a prison that offers the program. I put in the PDF of the release plan PDF for everyone to see. I see hands up. Dee Johnson, you the golfer? Talk to me. What's your question?
Hi there. Can you hear me?
Yes. Thank you.
I just wanted to say that I found a court in Cumberland County, North Carolina, that specializes in human trafficking victims. It assists them with the struggles that they have to move beyond their situations. And I will write them a letter this week. You're right, I do need to take the action instead of just thinking about it or putting another note in my notebook. So thanks for that. And I just wanted to make you aware that that's a resource that's out there.
I appreciate it very much. And success for this webinar, that's success as I see it. If you have an idea and it's something that you'd like to pursue, if you haven't put it to paper, if you haven't begun to develop the plan, begin to develop it, begin to create that plan. Because if not, you're going to be like so many prisoners who have really good intentions, who have done really good things. There's someone on our webinar with whom I spoke on Tuesday, Keith, who essentially said, I've really changed since my conviction. I've really learned these lessons and I really want to be productive, but I haven't documented it. I haven't shared it with anyone. I haven't clearly laid out the plan of how I've changed and what. And then he's like, I got to do that. If not, you're missing. All of you are missing opportunities. And if just some of you get that takeaway from this hour webinar today, we've done our job. We've done our job. I see more hands coming up. Any other hands? Any other questions? Okay. Let's see.
I've got a quick one, Jason and
Justin.
Or Justin, I'm sorry. With regard to the release plan book, I was only able to find online book number 2. Is there a volume 1 available as well?
Yes, we're going to go with volume 2. We have tons of content. I believe so. There's tons of content on our website, the Prison Professors Resource tab. In fact, I'm going to put up a link to that right now. I'd encourage you. Again, any book you purchase, if you do, it supports our nonprofit. We give away many of the PDFs anyway. For example, here's Earning Freedom by Michael. You can listen to him narrate each chapter. So if you prefer the PDFs, we give away so many of them. This is a great book that Michael wrote while I was with him in prison. You can listen to the audiobook. Earning Freedom's more macro, the 26-year journey through prison, earning prison one day. It's just one day in his journey. So I'll put up a link to this. And again, we sent you the PDF of the release plan. But if you want the actual one, it's here. But those who are working with us on the post-sentencing, we're going to send those to you while you're in custody. But version 2 is the one that you're going to want to work with.
Got it. Thank you. And I did check with the BOP.gov website, and there's still nothing on there for me. But
it could take some time. And sometimes they forget to even submit the paperwork. The marshals may not get it, but we got to push them. And but you have a while to your surrender. So I think we're okay giving it through the new year.
Right. And does the probation officer that you're assigned or the one that I've been working with, and then even post-sentencing, it's the same person here in Northern California, does that person remain with you through your journey or does that change out?
You can expect to have a new probation officer once you're done with prison.
Okay.
And different from the pretrial services officer, different than the person who wrote your probation report. Perhaps in some instances, maybe if the districts are very small, they could cover it both. But most of the time, you're going to have a separate probation officer once you're done with prison. Many people have said, I don't even know who my probation officer is. So how and why would I write them or how could I? Just send it to the probation office. Make a copy of it with a copy card you'll buy in the commissary and add it to your release plan because someday you're going to print it out, you know, like a book, right? So this is a book. It's an asset. All of you, Mark, Frank, Jason, all of you should have something akin to this that you could print out, give away, give it to people, right? Scott Laney, who's not on today, discusses how when people ask him about prison, they're like, oh, you went to prison. Can we not talk about it? Instead, they ask him about his progress in prison because he documented it. He shares it. It totally transforms the conversation. So whether you're doing it for your network, a potential employer, or if you don't want to do it for them, at least do it for the people that are going to play a role. But we do stress that you be authentic and be very honest.
No, absolutely. And I'm a little unique because I'm the case and my sentencing was Southern District in New York. My life will be the Northern District of California, based San Francisco. And then subsequently as well, any documents like the PSR or any of the sentencing memorandums, et cetera, of course, I'll be forwarding to you and others to start our journey together and start working with. But I just want to get right out in front of this and start doing my writing now.
It's a good idea. And I'd follow the template that Michael laid out and get creative and add to it. And again, if it's something you'd like our team to work with you on a review, just.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I couldn't, like I told
you. And I'm saying, I'm saying that, yeah, to everyone who's listening.
No, I said, and I'll be right out in the open. I said, working with you and the organization, I said, my quote was, this is as important as oxygen. And that, I'm just putting everything in front of it. Because it's the difference between you living and dying, in my opinion.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much for saying, we want to help. We want to continue to provide these resources every week to all of you going through this very difficult it's just difficult. There's no way to spin it. But if you do the work, if you invest the time and you tell them, you just don't tell them, you show them. We just think you advance your agenda at every stage of the journey. Someone asked, my son has several years left on his sentence. Is it a good idea for him to tell his case manager what his plan is upon release? Again, that kind of comes back to what we've discussed. It's one thing to go into a team meeting and tell the case manager. It's another thing to have written it out, Kath. That's the takeaway you need to tell your son. Son, write out what programs you're participating in and put it into your release plan. Write out, son, how the programs are helping you. Write out book reports. Why did you read the book? How will it help you? That's more impactful, we think, than just walking into a case manager's office and telling them what you're going to do. If there's no record of it, then they're just going to say it's happy talk. Well, okay, we don't believe you. How do we really know that it's true? So I love the idea, Kath, of a release, of sharing it with a case manager, but just don't tell them. That's all they hear every day. They're just used to being told things with no action to follow through. You're on this webinar to ensure that your son has a different journey. And that's what I suggest he does immediately. And also, if he hasn't started the release plan, we'd encourage him to look backwards and write out everything he's done in prison and be very honest and authentic about it. There are people who haven't had the most productive journey or who wasted time or had some disciplinary infractions and then they change. Show that progress. Don't make it all, everything's perfect and I'm great. Show that transition. Now, lastly, I want to say, I know some of you may thinking, I don't need to make any transition. I don't need to change anything. I think this whole effing thing is ridiculous. I know some of you are thinking that, and it may be true. But if you want the most successful experience, potentially getting out earlier, higher levels of liberty, engage in it, do it. as hard as it may be. But I'm aware that some of you may not actually need this release plan. I'm not naive, but we just want you to put yourself in the shoes of the stakeholders. Makes sense?
I even listened to the comment you made yesterday about quarantining, and you said, Frank, don't worry, things change. And so just from the standpoint of gravitas and listening, I'm going for a fifth COVID booster on Saturday. And because it's available. And then lastly, just a real quick question was, with regard to some of the release calculators, were you able to find the bug in it?
So Sam and I are going to go through the release calculator with you. Sam, are you still here? Can we go through the calculator real quick?
Again, I can't open it up on my screen,
but you can tell me what to do. If everyone wants to stay on,
thank you. How are you?
we're going to go through a quick demonstration of our release calendar for Frank. We're going to get an idea of what that could look like. So let me actually pull up the calculator once.
Okay. And again, if people have questions specifically to their sentencing situation and want to run through the release calculator, contact me. We can schedule some time to speak.
So I'm in the right spot, correct?
Yes. Okay, so let's type
in. I'll put in my information, Frank, and then I'll email it to you.
Okay, thanks. Or, you can put mine in. I'm fine. I'm fine with that.
Justin, you have to use your email address.
Hold on. Okay. Hold on one second. Bear with me for a moment. Okay, I'll put in Frank's email.
No, put in yours so we can look at it together.
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah. Cause I want to trust me, Frank, we know what we're doing here. We're experts. Okay. So original sentence, Sam, it's a sentence of 12 months and one day.
So put in there 13. What is the start date, Frank?
April 24, 2023.
Okay. Have you spent any time prior to this incarcerated?
No, just when I was arrested, just
put in 29, Justin, because you couldn't drop to 12 in a day and we had to put 13 in. So under prior jail time credit, put 29 days in there.
Got it. Thank you. Very helpful.
How would you do 29 when I didn't serve any time?
No, just we understand that for purposes of the calculator and the way it computes, we have to add 13 months and then give you the credit to take it back to 12 months in one day for purposes.
For purpose of pattern score, Justin, put the number 2 in there for low and put under FTC, put in 4. Hit submit. And now it's going to get emailed to you. Once it gets emailed to you, let's open it up on the screen.
Now, Sam, I'll put up a link for everyone to access the calculator. Can you quickly tell people, Sam, when they use the calculator on their own, why they should put in a specific number here? Yeah. Like what they should put in for the low pattern?
So pattern. We have to have positive numbers in each of those fields. When you first surrender to prison, and please, everyone who has not surrendered, I cannot stress this enough. The first thing you need to do when you get there is go to the computer where you're going to use your email, where you're setting up your contact list. There's an online assessment survey. You need to fill out that online needs assessment survey before you do anything. That assessment survey is what will trigger your eligibility for the First Step Act and start counting time. I can't tell you how many people call and say they were 11 months into their sentence and no one told them to fill out the survey, but they've been working and taking classes. Guess what? It's a problem. So first thing you do when you get there in front of a computer, when you set up your contact list, fill out the online needs assessment survey. The reason you need to put a 2 in there is typically until your first or second team meeting with the case manager, you're considered low. It's just how the BOP calculates your recidivism pattern score doesn't have any bearing on the fact that it considers low. So by putting in 2 in there, we factor in that the first 2 months you're going to be there will be low. So you would get 10 days for every 30 days of productive activities as opposed to 15. We also want to be more conservative.
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. I'm going to put up a link for everyone to access our calculator as you spend time on prison professors. The email has not come yet, but it will. What I'll do is, Frank, I'll forward you the email once it arrives, because it has not arrived. And then on our next webinar, I'll have it set up in advance where I can actually have the data in front of me. And I can show someone, this is the information we inserted, this is how to use it, and this is what the sentence length will be. But I don't want to hold everyone up while I wait for the email to arrive. No, it's
okay. And you know, we'll probably talk sooner than that, because I'm going to be sending you over a bunch of data, like the PSR, the post, the sentencing memorandums and everything for you, Sam. Hi again. And everybody start looking at as we start working together.
Yeah, that's fine. Short of that, I know it's quarter after 11, getting ready to go to Christmas. Hope it's wonderful for everyone, Hanukkah and our family. Are there any other questions I can answer before we conclude our webinar on the release plan?
I've sent the release plan information to everybody that's asked me for it.
Thank you. Thank you for doing that. And again, we give everything we can away for prison professors. But if you have specific questions about the narrative, if you feel the message is off, or the release plan, you're concerned about the messaging, I'd encourage you to coordinate a call with Sam, who can offer some additional insights. Short of that, use our free resources, build, create, and you're gonna advance your agenda. Okay.
Have a good holiday.
Thank you all very much. Merry Christmas, everyone. Thank you all so much for joining our community. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone. And thanks so much again, Michael,
everyone. Thank you.